Yeah.
Here it
There it
comes.
comes.
All right, how far behind is it? And watch for
Tap,
that and
tap,
see.
tap, tap. About
Oh
3
my
seconds.
gosh, we're right on top. Do you
Are we?
see that?
I didn't see
We
it.
got
Do it
like a
again.
1 second delay.
Do it again.
Boom,
I'm good to go.
boom.
This is more like 3 seconds on my end.
But that's less than 3 seconds. That's
Maybe
amazing.
two.
We got no viewers though, is a problem.
Oh,
Oh,
we're already
Twitch is
live?
slow. Oh
Twitch
yeah,
is
we're live.
slow.
Damn it.
Zuckerberg's on a Tuesday night are fast. There's already 50 is on Zuckerberg's.
It's a blurry looking screen at the moment, but I think that'll catch up. But the delay is just less than I've ever seen. Mitch back in the house.
Mitch always up in here.
Mitch on the video tonight too.
Quick. Oh yeah, Mitch is in the video.
First comment and featured in the video.
Tonight, everybody get excited because tonight is like a full-length feature film. We're doing the movie song, and we made a movie for it. And I just want to say it'll make you laugh. It'll make you cry. Maybe even get scared a little
Maybe a little
bit.
scared.
Devin is in the movie, and you will never see his face, which I
Never.
just think is, man, I'd kill for people not to see my face. When they see mine, all I get is the jokes.
Damn, talk about spoiler alert. The second the stream comes on, he'll tell you everything that happened in the dramatic film he just made. There's
Nope,
already a hundred.
I didn't give away the ending.
We got 166 Zuckerbergs.
The 166 Zuckerbergs.
20 something on Twitch.
Yeah, Twitch
Twitch
is
is slow
blowing
and
up.
steady.
Kraken's here.
Facebook's all excited. There's Emery, and then they taper off when we're
Well, what
not doing
happened to
anything
our?
but
We used to
talking.
have tunes. We can't do tunes anymore. Where they shut
Matt
us
didn't
down?
want to. I don't know.
Well,
Oh, because
okay.
we'll get
First of
shut
all,
down.
Facebook acting like they're going to shut us down anyway.
Yeah, I know. If we play
Still?
our own song that we don't own.
Right, because we're just no, just like Facebook. You saw the thing they said about there's a look it up. Maybe it's on the damn news tonight. I don't know, but there's
Sure
the
was.
Facebook said they're going to start blocking and deleting videos and stuff of bands that and people doing music experiences on their platform. Like even doing
Cool.
live music. But I think they're probably mostly trying to get at DJs. So it's unclear if they're really going to block rock bands, but they're saying their policy would be to do something like block us on what we're going to do tonight, like playing live songs into the damn internet. So it's their in their
Zuckerberg
rules now.
sucks.
Yeah, I mean it's weird. We'll see. But I think it's more about how everybody's just DJing and then maybe they have to pay the intellectual property on that or something. I don't
I
know.
think it's less about bands and more about, DJ and stuff like that.
But if I play the
But
Spotify right now, that's what this
we'd
would
get in
count as,
trouble.
basically.
What's up, Wanna Banger?
Yo, we got Matt McDonald up in here, y'all.
McDonald, you said you just want a banger in your group too? Does he show up on your Twitch?
No, he just said my name. Spelled it wrong, but I respect that. It's
I want to
fine.
see
It's an attempt.
what crossover
Hold
Twitch
on,
people
McDonald, you spell without looking again, spell Wanabanger.
Exactly how it sounds.
What?
Wanabanger is a good name. It's good. What's up?
All right, I'm gonna go get another beer real quick. Y'all chit
I wish
chat.
I had a beer. You didn't even invite me over to your house or nothing and can't even get a beer. Good God.
Yeah, I'm gonna drink some tequila tonight because I can drink a couple more days until BC69 starts, which is our workout deal. It starts on Friday, so probably
Yeah.
drink tonight and Thursday a little bit, and that'll be it till Thanksgiving.
Oh
But I got some
God.
tequila here.
I have some tequila too, but I've already been drinking a few, so I just don't think I can keep going. It's already 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock. Who drinks after 8 o'clock p.m.?
Almost nobody drinks after 8 o'clock. I mean, that's
Now,
weird.
1
That would be
p.m.
weird.
If it was 1 p.m. right now, it feels like, oh, all my life is ahead of me. I need a beverage to enjoy the rest of the day. But 8 p.m.? What in the world am I drinking then for?
Hey, whose mic is way too low? Matt Carter or me?
Matt Carter, Matt McDonald. McDonald
Come on,
sounds
chat.
normal to me.
Yeah, it sounds normal to me, but I don't know.
Carter. Yeah,
Okay, well,
they said your mic's a little low. Woo!
let's see. I can
All
turn
right.
it up, I guess.
I gotta
Is
get
that
over
louder?
there.
Is that
Get
better?
you.
Hey, I'll just crank it. Hey. Is that distorted
No, it
or
sounds
better?
same to me, but maybe out there in the real world.
But it's
What's
not
the
that
problem?
bad. I can be closer to it. I can be louder.
It is
It
so
sounds
funny.
fine to me, but
My kids are doing virtual learning, So I'll be walking through whatever, and the teacher will go, all right, such and such, what is da 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 da? And the kid, this kid talks, and the next one, and then she'll get to the third one. All right, what do you think it is? Santa, Christmas,
good God. No parent, how could you do that to your kid? You don't know anything about audio? You never had a television that you set the audio up a little bit? Anything?
Shot 3.5. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No, no.
I'm like, good God. Georgia has a boy in her class who doesn't, like, he's the classic can't sit still or pay attention. You know what I mean? He has a, you know, an adult with him usually when he's at school. He's one of my favorite kids. He, the first day of school with her teacher, he said pussy twice during the third class. And the teacher just kind of went past it, like didn't make it. What are you going to do? Like, it's not like in where you can get them.
Right.
It's just you're better to let it go. It's where you're going to stop. You can't go over to the side and talk to him yet. And he wasn't trying. He was just repeating something his brother or dad said and stuff like that. It was like
that's funny.
First 30 minutes of the first day.
In first grade?
Second grade? Yeah. So great. I was so happy. I was just so happy. I couldn't believe it. Like, seeing other kids kind of cut up in school, I mean, I just still don't know. I mean, that's what I think this is, you know? Like, that's just my playground is whatever the vibe is of kids cutting up in school. That's pretty much it, my wavelength.
Yep. All right, what are we going to do tonight, guys?
Well, we've got a jam-packed show.
Jam-packed.
We've got a video that we've done for the movie song that's above average. It's well above average as we continue to add to our production songs each week. Toby put in a last minute cover song that is very good. It was just, he just put it in. I just now found it, put a mix on it, and it was the cool thing about it is I put the I just pulled the mix settings from the movie song. So it went from being a little video you did right there to having this real polished vocal sound. It's cool. I was like, it's a really good song too, with a good vocal take. And then Devin's gonna do a live song. A very, very old one. And then Matt McDonald's going to do a song. What you got? What kind of song are you going to do? He's going to do a live one here.
Yeah, I figured I'd do an old one, acoustic. So.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
So, Matt McDonald, you do a stream normally, or you did do it normally, but did you stop your series? What's your future of streaming? I was talking about that with you the other day up at your house on whatever that
was. Yeah, Labor Day. When we canceled all the tours, then we were like, well, we got to do something because we just put out a record at the beginning of a global pandemic, which wasn't awesome. But so everyone was in lockdown, and Christy and I just thought we would just go live on Friday nights and do acoustic stuff. And that we called that Quarantunes, and we did that on Twitch, and it was super fun. But like after 14 weeks of it, I was like, okay, I gotta figure out what I'm going to do next because I can't just do this like every week forever, or else I'll never do another record. So I'm in the process of transitioning to another record, but I'm going to do songwriting sessions on Twitch when I'm writing that record. So
nice.
I like it. It's cool. It's a cool platform.
You were doing good on tips and stuff and floating, you know, being able to pay your rent and stuff just from doing those for a while. Is that something you think would be long-term for you revenue wise?
Well, I'd have to keep doing it all the time. And I'm not like you guys. I don't like to, you know, saddle myself with all the obligation. do it if I don't want to. But it was fun. And so I want to do like kind of seasonal stuff. Just like, come on when I'm working on a project or doing something. And, you know, I plan on streaming like every week, most days, maybe 4 days a week when I'm writing. So, you know, that'll be as regular as it gets for me probably.
So I think that's a big difference in all of our styles here. But you know, I've seen you on Twitch writing songs. And you know, we Twitch a lot, we do a lot of stuff, but I've been trying so hard to make it where I could turn on my screen share and my mic, like while I was producing and working or arranging or playing. And I just can't get my mind there yet because I'm not thinking about talking and then I'm not getting the work done and I just can't do both, and it's a vulnerable thing to share. So I'm curious, like, how is it hard? Does it not less productive, and is it not too scary to share your writing like that?
When I first started it was difficult. I didn't understand even the concept of Twitch. I was just going live, and I didn't get that. Like, people want to see you do nothing. You know, people are fine to watch you step out of the room or take a break or do whatever. Like, I just felt like I had to be on, and then when I was off, I turned the stream off. But the more I did it, the more I realized it. Like, and I even put a command in our chat called dead eyes when my eyes go dead because I'm thinking and I can't pay attention to chat. So like, it explains what's going on. So whenever I would focus on a song, people would drop the dead eyes in the chat, and then people who were just tuning in would understand, like, oh, Matt's not you know, a zombie. He's actually focusing on a part or whatever. And so I could kind of ignore chat a little bit when I had to focus. Yeah, I'm definitely not there yet, but I see people doing their best to do what they're really, really good at and be in that flow state while on stream. I think it's a difficult thing to pull off, but when I see people do it, and when I see them try hard, like when I see them stop looking at the chat and really try hard, I like to watch that. I like to watch when they're actually playing the video game or whatever it is that they're good at, you know, without even like thinking of it as a performance or that people need to be entertained by your talking or anything like that.
Yeah, this might sound like an obnoxious statement, but I think being able to do that particular multitask is the skill of the century.
Yeah.
I believe that, though, because it's a creative skill, like to do something fully creative and have the other level of awareness, communicative during, and being able to share that. I really believe that is the skill of the future.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I'm interested in it, but I don't possess it.
Yeah, the guys that are really good at it, I find, are really good at staying in like a really concentrated state. But they're talking to themselves, but they're kind of talking to chat.
Yeah.
So like,
interesting.
When I'm focused on something, I often talk to myself. So if I can just do that with the chat there, then that's more of a, they can kind of understand what's going on inside my head. But yeah, it's a tough thing to figure out.
Can Devin and Toby, y'all wrap your mind around doing songwriting from scratch here? With just maybe, even if it wasn't even us, just you with on Twitch right here with these people. Could you do that? Would you like it?
Well, I think for me, it would just be like, I would kind of have to just, like Mac was saying, just not acknowledge that it's on, really. Mm-hmm. It'd be like, maybe occasionally somebody would ask me a question and I'd say, oh, yeah, whatever. But mostly it'd be me, like, normal, sitting here playing my guitar.
I think I could do it if I attached it to an OnlyFans account and I was naked.
Yeah.
Then I'm not thinking. Then I know everybody's focusing on my neck.
The good stuff.
You know what I mean? My butthole.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that way I'm free to write music. I'm free to be creative. Speaking of music, let's play a song. We don't have any intro music. Let's get to a song.
Who's
here?
Who's first? Who wants to go first?
It doesn't matter. You can play my cover song, or Devin can play a song live.
Well,
I don't care.
Toby's cover song is so good and mixed that why don't we do a acoustic song, a live song first?
Yeah, I'll do it.
Okay. Devin, are you prepared? Are you ready?
I'm not at all ready.
He's nervous. He's got stage fright.
All right. I hope I remember this. I literally haven't played this song in probably 15 years until like 20 minutes ago.
How many times? So you ran it one. What do you do? Just run it one time? Just to make sure you know it?
Yeah. I'd look up the lyrics to make sure I remembered.
I'll tell a quick story about this song. It's To Whom It May Concern. It didn't even make the week's end. It was prior to the week's end. And we even made a record. We recorded it with Ed Rose and didn't even put it on the album, right?
Yeah, I think.
And it came out as a B-side.
It just felt like a little different style or something, kind of, you know. Mm-hmm. And then didn't we like remix it or redo something to it?
Probably.
And we put it on something. I think maybe The Question Deluxe or something like that.
It was one of the first songs we ever wrote together. And we wrote it in Seattle well before the week's end and played it live for a year or two, including we made a version of it that we got on the radio with, if y'all remember that, when we had the song competition at KGRG, and we called in and had some people call in and voted, and we won the best new song on the local radio station.
Yep.
Y'all remember that? And it was like the best shift of moments. It's like, wait, it's all going to really happen for us. We were a local band and we sent a song.
I remember we went out and sat in my, I think it was my Honda Accord or maybe Seth's car.
Yeah.
And it was coming on the radio, and we turned on the radio, and all of us were sitting in there, and we listened to the contest, us versus another band, and we won. That was crazy.
It's one of the most exciting moments. So, like, it's kind of like a light version of that thing you do, you know, when they heard their song.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, though, we did cheat because it was that thing where you called in and voted for which song, and we all called in, I think, from the same phone. But we only had one cell phone.
Yeah.
Yeah, the vote was probably like 7-2 or something.
Yeah, it was probably like 7-2.
No one else was listening. It's like 5 p.m. in Seattle, and we were going, I really like that Emery song. Trying to change our voices.
All right, I'll see if I can play. Dave.
The tip jar is out and open. We'll do a tip contest too today. We'll talk about that. But.
Hey, I am Justin. Thanks for the cheer 100 for buttholes.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
Does this sound okay? Everybody hear my guitar?
The three of us had to be totally silent so it doesn't squelch you. But
okay. All right. Here we go. Falling away from you, falling away from you always seems so tragic in my eye. I hear that you're doing well now. Things I wish I could have heard from. It's been so long since the first time we tried. Oh, but anyway, and all my friends say hello. The soft sheets and daylight surround me. She's gone, they tell me. Are you listening? For the life of me, I can't see through this haze of sleepless dreaming. Light breaks the morning, shades wake but rise no more. I could have called her the night before. Empty, broken promises lost. I never said goodbye. I never had the time. I never said goodbye. For the life of me, I can't see through this haze of sleepless dreaming. Light breaks the morning, shades wake but rise no more. I should have called her the night before. You were broken. Now everything's lost, and all I see falling away from you all.
Blammo!
All right, Devin.
Now it's time to fire emojis, and the fire emojis bring the tip rain. That's the formula here.
Fire emojis.
You got to build the fire first. So
Got to build it.
If you didn't like it, don't put a fire emoji in there. Mm-hmm. It's pretty simple.
That's true.
Yeah.
Don't.
No fire.
But if you did like it, heat it up, and then the tips will rain. You got it. And how about to add to that, if you tip the most, we'll give you a test pressing of the Only a Man update. We got one of those to give away or two?
We got
two. Is it one? Two.
Yeah, let's do two.
Got two?
So we got two again this week. So top two all tippers right. will be giving away a I'm Only a Man test press.
So much fire.
I'm Only a Man being the project we're in the middle of now. We have the movie song tonight. Then we have Nickel Slick and Crypto Coffin, and we will complete our journey through the I'm Only a Man update in the next 2 weeks. Yeah. But that's exciting. If you're just catching us, we're redoing that whole album from 2007 with an updated recording that we think is much better. And you can have whatever opinion you like about the other one, but this one's really good too, or maybe even better. And we're pressing it on vinyl, which has been really fun. You can get all that emerymusic.com and see some of the other ones we've done. And yeah, test press tips, all that.
So much.
Y'all were talking about.
What made you guys pick that record to redo?
Because it fucking sucked, Mac. Okay.
It wasn't that bad.
You know, no, good
he's
well.
Gonna make us say it.
You he's think it sounded bad?
Yeah, no. I hate it.
No, well, okay.
There's just a ton of problems with it. There's things that sound great on it, though. Like, there's really cool things on it, and it has a lot of weird character, like '90s records that are like sound weird. At least it sounds weird. But you know, I hear a lot of errors in the tracking, recording, production, and performances. Yeah,
so,
I just you know.
So we've talked about this on the stream and stuff before, Mac, but. When we recorded it, we had, you know, we had 6 weeks to basically just do whatever we wanted, take our time. We did pre-production, then we did the album, and it was a blast. Like, we had so much fun. We loved our producer. We loved every single thing about it. But when we got to the final stages of it, there were some things that just didn't get done the way we really wanted them to done. Vocals weren't as polished as we would like. They weren't quite as tuned or you know, it just there was a few things like that, and some of the production quality, which Ryan, who did our album, he was a little bit more of the rough guy. Like, he worked with Ross Robinson, did heavy stuff all the time, stuff that you kind of wanted a little bit of mistakes and a little bit of, you know what I mean? And so this album just wasn't that, and so we had a little bit of that conflict of production quality wasn't exactly what we wanted. But we love the songs and we love the whole process of that album. But we wish it would have come out just a little different. So,
all right.
And we can't press it on vinyl.
And the craziest thing is that you can do it yourself now and do a better job than whatever that budget was.
Yeah, $100,000. It's cheaper this way.
It's just a little cheaper now.
Yeah. Right. Well, no, I'm sorry. We've increased. Okay. Let me do a new math for you. Okay, so it might have been like 80,000, 90,000, but just say it's $10,000 a song to make those songs. So when we do a song, it's a $10,000 production we've done this week. Now, in 2007, how much did it cost to make a music video?
Oh, unbelievable.
$20,000.
Did we make any videos then, and were they any good?
No.
We
did make videos. They're terrible.
Is the one we made tonight better or worse than those?
It's a different universe. Is an alternate reality. It's unbelievable how much better it is.
Okay, so tonight's production that we did this week in 2008 would have been $30,000. What it would have cost to produce something worse than we're going to play later tonight.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, and it only took this since you saw us last from scratch.
Right.
So to me, that's just exciting. I don't care. There's not. I mean, you know, we're gonna make $200 in tips. I mean, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. But it's just worth doing. We're selling, you know. But to me, I get such a kick out of that. So,
McDonald, what was y'all's record that threw you for a loop that you thought was? Did y'all have one that you were like, oh, that didn't turn out like we thought? Maybe not fan reaction or whatever.
Every record was that for us.
It never has not been that.
Yeah, I mean, I think probably our third record was the most disappointed I'd been. Because going into it, kind of the guys, a lot of them had started going back to school. And I'd always written like a lot. But that record I wrote like 95% of everything. And I thought we were going to go into the studio and we're going to work stuff out in pre-pro and people are going to bring parts and add changes and do stuff. And then no one really did anything. They just barely played the demos that I made. So, or at least that was my perspective. Looking back now, the record Vagabonds, I actually really like it. It's like a cool snapshot. It's a cool vibe all the way through. the first song on the record just has two chords in it the whole time. It's cool. It's a thing. It has a vibe. But at the time I thought, you know, this is it. This is our, you know, this is our third record on the label. We got to make it happen. And nobody in my mind came together to do that. And then when it came out, I just remember, looking around, like on our, I think I've told this to Matt before, maybe on Labeled Podcast, but like looking around on stage at the Showbox Market, hating the new songs, hating my bandmates, hating the whole thing, and being like, this is the worst I've ever felt in my life. So yeah, I know what it feels like to put a lot into something, and then, I mean, even have a good time making it, right, and then have it just not go your way, because you're not in right. control ultimately, you know. And I was just thinking about this the other day, because I'm getting ready to start another record, but the decision tree for an album is huge. It's like there, like just an, it's just so many decisions have to go into building 10 songs that you're going to, yeah. you know, and not even from the writing, everything from the filtering and the effects and the structure and the, you know, on down through tracking and mixing. I mean, tracking is huge. And then mixing and mastering and artwork and just everything has to be tweaked, and there has to be 40 times going back and forth to make it perfect. And then you get this thing that you've like labored under for like a year and a half, and you bring it, and it just, you know, and that just feels like such a loss. It's almost like you raised a child and the child died or something, but it's not. I mean, like, it's not really obviously anything like that, but it feels like that. It's a labor of love, and then it just doesn't go the way you want.
Well, that's the analogy, so though, you know, in the creative world, it's like kill your babies, which, you know, means when you self cut something out of something that you liked or whatever. But that's the idea of thinking of your creative output as something that's alive or not, and that, you know, you yeah. ship out and it goes and has its own life. I think that's correct.
Yeah. And well, sometimes it dies immediately. Yeah.
And that was part of I'm Only a Man Too, is like, and I'm not sure which album you guys released around that same time, but when social media became more prevalent, the music industry kind of went down. And so at the same time that we created kind of this new feel album, different than The Question, all this stuff, that was when you could read all the comments.
For the first time, right. Good
and
access
for,
to comments.
And for you to spend 6 weeks, 2 months, all this time writing, kind of pouring your heart out, really getting into this, and then a split second one person has a comment that just says this sucks, and immediately you take it the most personal, because like you said, it's your baby that you just created.
Yeah,
and you're like, and 1 second a person just says, oh, this sucks, I don't like it.
It's
like,
is
what?
Like that, that's funny. That's if you crazy thought about, you post your baby newborn like on Facebook and a bunch of people are like, ah, eyebrows are lame.
Yeah. See, I think that's probably a similar experience. Like so much of those records, even ours that we did in 2009, it was kind of the biggest, it was the time where like everything came online and all the feedback you got, it didn't really matter what magazines were saying or what reviewers were saying. It was like people just on the comments section. And I wonder if that colored or amplified the negative, reaction, like that even the band has towards the record. Like, I think a lot of people actually like that record a lot, but it was the first time where people could be really vocal and really actually get to the bandmates and get to you, you know, on social media. And 13 years later, you don't give a shit if someone says one bad thing.
Right.
Or hopefully you got used to it, but like back fresh and so vivid and like painful, you know?
Oh, yes.
Absolutely. It's funny too, though. It's like, because you're right, you make so many decisions to make a record, and then somebody can just point to one thing, like, oh, that song was too poppy or something. But you're like, what are you talking about? They can just say something so vague and it says you suck, and you're like, yeah, but I mean, so much went into it. There's so many decisions and hours and thoughts and this thing, and you know, there's so many little neat little things that I remember about these records that we make. And then it's just like, yeah, this is stupid.
But
yeah.
does that, I mean, think about it this way. Now, of course, that person's dumb and you probably would have done it the same anyway in that specific case. But what if you had a bunch of people that told you that, back to what McDonald's saying, if he's going to write a song on Twitch,
Yeah.
And people were saying, when you've only spent 15 minutes on it, this is dumb and poppy. Would it be right or wrong to let that then affect you? Wouldn't that just be, then you don't have to go through the whole decision tree and spend the money and then get the comment.
Yeah, they don't know what they're talking about. Yeah.
Right, right. But, I mean, well, could that play a part?
Yeah, I did have a few people, like, trying to tell me what to do when I was working on, like, drums and stuff. Somebody who was a drummer, right?
Yeah.
Like, you need to do like this. It needs more like that. I'm like, dude, this is a demo. Like, I'm going to get a drummer to trying to explain to him, like, I'm not trying to, like, flavor this up. I'm getting just the basics, and then I'm going to, you know, actually have someone play. But, yeah, I think music is one of those things where not many people can do it. Like, just talk about songwriting, because a lot of people can play an instrument, but to write a song, basically nobody can do it. Nobody can do it well, you know?
Yeah.
But every single person has an opinion on what a good song is. It's this weird thing where it's like, and it's such a subjective personal opinion, but it's like, there's no way that, you know, it's just the weirdest art form in that, like, everybody consumes it. Everybody has an ideal form that they seek from it, but nobody can actually do it. And so it's just really easy to get the judgment from people who don't really even know what they're talking about.
Yeah, you're right.
But that's the beauty of it too, you know?
What's bizarre too is when you say that, it makes me think about like pop music or the most popular music in the world most often isn't written by the artist that's performing it. They need a whole other artist to entertain or to bring that song to life. Somebody else writes it, and then a team works on it. And then, I mean, all that music that you listen to on the radio is written by a bunch of other people. You know what I mean? That aren't performing the song at all. And we are in the world where not only do we have to write it, but we have to perform it and see it to fruition all that. Yeah, exactly.
Split there of that. Well, that's the difference in, you know, like, what are we, a little rural farmer versus specialized crop, specialized industry where everything's split out, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Like, we know how to fix the fence and till the soil and raise, you know, we have to do what we do.
Yeah.
You're right, though. That's why it's so hard. Like, you have somebody that writes beats, like back in the day, Dr. Dre or something, and his beats would go for $1 million because they were just great. And other people couldn't do it as good, so he's going to get top dollar.
He couldn't rap as good, so other people would write his rap.
Yeah, right. So he.
I wish I had
so,
that in my life.
Yeah, I know.
Well, you want to play a song? You want to do an old one?
Is it my turn?
Yeah, your turn.
Okay, I'll do it. Yeah.
Sweet.
You know what? Is it? How does it sound over Skype? I don't.
It's fine. Back up.
It's
just
fine.
Like a back up, like, you know. 12 inches from where you are, so you get a good mix of the mic and stuff. But just try it. We'll see. It'll sound good.
I've got an extra mic down here,
no,
too.
No, it'll be good. If you back up enough, you'll get both, but not too far back.
And what if I put a little sauce on it, you know?
If
does
you
that
can,
sound
yeah.
okay?
Yeah, man.
How do you route
salt?
It? What route
I'm just
do you
going. I'm just
that?
Going through my Apollo Twin.
So I got one of those.
Yeah, it's just going through the console and coming out of that into Skype.
So use the processing in the console to go into Skype.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. Are you gonna put it in full screen?
Oh yeah, I'm gonna put you in. I didn't do that for Devin, did I?
I know. I
texted. Nodded my
head. I
texted you, but I'm sorry. Look at this.
Okay, hey, that's all right.
Look at that.
Oh, there we go.
Oh, that looks good.
Oh my God, look at that.
Maybe
man.
I should back up.
Wow.
Okay. That's a okay.
Good looking ginger beard right there.
Yeah, it's growing.
McDonald told me not to give Devin full screen. We agreed before.
Damn it. Well, I need the sauce. I don't want to go after Devin.
McDonald's the headliner.
That's why I got the sauce. So this is Glass Houses from Phoenix, which came out 8 years ago, 2012. It was our first independent album that we put out. So I'm going to play it because it's easy. They talk of glass houses. I built a crystal cathedral, and I took my stones to the rooftop to play target practice with people.
I was too young to know the difference. I was just following orders. But when the glass shattered around me, I learned a good lesson about my disorder. I thought I was happy. I said all the right things. I naively believed my ship couldn't sink, but it did. You got hung up on the outside. You faked like you're living the good life. But death and decay on the inside just add pride and hate to your long list of crimes. Somewhere deep down you know the difference between love and following orders. But if the chorus I sing is offensive, it's proof that you've yet to address your disorder. I thought...
No, it goes.
You thought you were happy. You said all the right things. You naively believed your ship couldn't sink, but it did. You thought you were God and judge of all of your friends, and you naively believed your ship couldn't sink, but it did. Comes to those who pray, comes to those who pray through tears, and they'll sing, and we'll all sing. La da da da, la da 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 da, la da da da, la da 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 da, oh, la da 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 da. La ta da ta da. We thought we were happy. We said all the right things. We naively believed our ship couldn't sink, but it did. We thought we were God and judge of all.
Was right on.
Okay, so that's fire emoji nice. Territory, and I thought I wanted to text Devin and Toby and tell the appropriate response for us when somebody does that on this show is when we come back to the full screen, you got to fall out of your seat. That's what.
Just fall out.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I cut from him back to you. If you like the performance, they're gonna fire right. emoji, and you fall out.
I love
that
it.
That was awesome, McDonald. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me.
You have that ability to, go there, get all the way up there, kind of thing. Like you're like I really think that's a real skill to be able to be in wherever you are now in your studio by yourself, connected on a Skype call. Like most people are on a Zoom call for like a meeting. I mean, if you could think about how that would feel to be in a Zoom call at your meeting and then have to do what you did, like right. it's a bigger gap than people realize. That oh, you're a performer, you're a singer, whatever. But yeah. Imagine that Zoom meeting you're sitting in, and then you had to do that into the live mic broadcast right. over the internet, Skype quality, all that. It takes, you know, it takes some real
guts. It's never as good as when you do it by yourself. But that's the thing, is like being in front of actual people is way easier than being in front of a screen performing.
Right.
It just feels awkward, you know. And I'm I'm alone in a room, but I can hear people down the hall in my studio area, so I can hear them talking, so I know they can hear me too. Mm-hmm. So that's like an extra.
You carry that bandwidth in your head. Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I carry from behind my head too. Exactly. It's like, stop looking at me.
I'll give a little plug. It was funny today. We were talking about that same thing. We interviewed Tim from Under Oath. And just talking about their observatory thing and all that. So you can go listen to it tomorrow, but it was interesting just hearing about what they decided to do and what's coming next. We had that conversation of, I mean, Matt, you, Carter, you made this point that it might not, I mean, is it going to go back to normal? Like, when is the time where you're excited to be in a mosh pit again? Like, you know, when will you be like, okay, yeah, I can go do that or something? I mean, that might be a very long time, if ever. And so we are going to have to do stuff like this. Musicians are going to be in the virtual world and putting on shows, and you're going to see real talent, and there'll be less bands and less businesses in the world, but the best are going to do good. I'm not saying we're the best. I'll be working at Home Depot in 2023, but I mean, it's going to be interesting to see, you know, Zoom calls and playing music are going to be way more normal than you think. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just that is what is going to happen.
Well, if you think about moshing, it's almost that's what's special about our kind of music, is that's performance too. Like, you see the kid hardcore dancing. Yeah. He's trying to get more attention than you on the stage. I mean, that's essentially what he's doing. Right. If you look at animals like peacocks or birds dancing or something, it's some mating behavior, you know, it's whatever. And so, you know, that's really
skanking.
You know, and this chat that happens here, like, this is very primitive stuff, but there's an art form to being good in the chat here, right? You can be a good you can be a good member of the chat, just like you can learn to hardcore dance and get it. Like, we're trying to make the things a different thing happen. It's not the other thing, but there's something that can actually happen versus just broadcast here. And so the sky's the limit on who's going to come up with a clever way to do something on a Zoom call that's actually super fun, like a digital mosh or something. Who knows what they'll come up with, but all the ideas are in the future. And so as far as back to normal, that's not my wavelength at all. That's just where we're going, you know?
Yeah, I don't think it'll go back to normal, but I think it'll go back. And I think there'll be a period of time once shows start again that it'll be like absolutely insane. Like, there'll be a period of time that'll be maybe 6 months, maybe a year, that it'll be just unreal amounts of people at every show, like, that you can think of.
That's
because they're just going to be like, I have to go out and do this. And then I think it'll taper off and maybe just kind of be a little different moving forward, but I think there will be a time of just excess, like, everybody's just going to do everything.
Like, if you go, you go, well, I'm not going to, like, you tell your wife, it's just like, you're going to the show, you're like, yeah, I'm going to go, I'm going to sit, you know, back at the bar, and then you go, you just get that old-fashioned feeling, you'll be in the, you swore you wouldn't go in the pit, but you're going to get in it, right? You're just going to do it. You know what I mean? You said you're going to sit in the back, but once you see it, you get that old-fashioned feeling, you're going to be in there. But coming home and acting like, what are you talking about? I sat in the bar, I could barely, you know what? Sound wasn't even good, babe. I didn't have fun. You have a black eye.
Well, like, is COVID now, like, you get caught cheating on your wife? Like, you know, there's a pair of underwear in your coat pocket or something like that. Now you got COVID. They knew you went out to a show.
Yeah.
You did go to that show, didn't you? Yeah. You got COVID there. It's funny too, because it used to be you have to decide, you know, there's two or three bands coming to town and you only have money to see one or two of them, so you got to decide which show to go to. But now you have to decide, because which one are you willing to risk getting COVID for?
Yeah, which, like, other fans, you know, though, I mean? Do you think are sicker, though? I'm not going to that show, because those fans are sick as shit. Yeah. We're going to go to the ICP show? I don't think so.
Oh, no. Oh, God, no.
You know, which show would you mosh at? What's the cleanest mosh, you know? That's a new thing.
But, I mean, booking agents and venues are going to go away. So
that's true.
I mean,
he's right.
V- venues are already starting to close down. I saw August Burns Red posted their favorite venue, the Chameleon Club, which we've all played at multiple times. Wow. Closed down. Club? Yes.
Well, that, I'm not laughing about that.
No, that's in a bummer.
Lancaster, cool, Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah,
and that's like their home venue. They've probably played there 100 times.
Like,
or something.
Permanently. Like, it'll be sold or whatever.
That's, yeah, oh, that's fuck, what it looked like.
Why
that's
can't terrible. Their rich ass buy it? Good Lord. How many records they sell a day? It's ungodly. I can't help Chameleon Club.
I know.
Come on. August Burns Red. Good Lord.
Yeah, buy it.
Stop whining. Just buy it. You're rich ass. They got two or three pools each in their backyards. Can't help out Chameleon Club.
No.
Oh, we're going to miss it.
Shameful.
JB diving into his pool. I'm going to miss the Chameleon Club.
Hey, could you get me a martini, please? Thank you. But, I mean, I was thinking about like, our booking agent, who is kind of a part-time deal, but he hasn't done anything since March.
I know.
He spent probably a month trying to figure out the craziness, canceling every show possible, and then nothing.
Yeah, they've just they keep bouncing them down. Well, you know, we're going to do – it looks like it's going to be September. You know, okay. You know.
Probably going to be able to charge double, though. I mean, that'll be more commission for them.
But all the ticketing
of them?
Places, like the big stuff, you know, what's the big one?
Ticketmaster?
Live Nation.
Live Nation,
yeah. Those agencies, they're not giving guarantees like normal. So now it's like a door deal. Those big companies that were giving big guarantees are now giving you a couple bucks on the dollar. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Right.
Per person that
you
comes
know
in.
What might you want to hear a music conspiracy theory? I'll give you one. Live Nation is so big, they control everything. They probably have the ability to innovate and intentionally are not. They're the only ones in the position to like do something.
And they're just not.
And they won't, because of course they can weather the storm.
Right.
Yeah.
So if nothing changes and everybody freezes out, everything's gone. They're back. Two years or not. Like, they may be, for all you know, trying to make less shows happen less soon.
Right.
Yeah.
That might be a good business strategy for them. That's all I'm saying. You can spend I have no knowledge or any thought of that, but I'm just speaking about incentives.
You think they're buying venues behind the closed doors?
Well, I mean, maybe they're just gonna wait and then buy them. I mean, why wouldn't they just wait and buy them all? Like,
right,
that they're gonna be cheap soon. And they put out articles and talk about how they're losing millions or whatever. But I mean, you can do the math. I mean, how long would Jeff Bezos could lose millions for a long time, knowing if there's a bright future on the other side? I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, the bigger you are, you can weather the storm. And then after that, it's like, you've seen Forrest Gump, you know, when he's the only ship left after, and how much shrimp they caught.
I've seen it.
That's that. It's about to be the shrimp, you know. So, it's about to be the Bubba Gump Shrimp Company of
I have thought for a while that Bezos' idea will be to give each band one of those Sprinter Amazon vans, and you have packages, and when you get to your venue, people show up, they pick up their package and watch your band play, right? Like, it does everything. I mean, why would you get it? You get a van, you just got to also carry some packages with you from, you know, whatever.
Right.
From Indianapolis.
You just
got to
have room
Cincinnati.
In your trailer. Yeah.
Yeah. You just got room in your trailer, and you just, you know, you're there. And I mean, because they have those lockers now where you go pick up your stuff anyway.
Right.
So why not pick it up at a rock venue where your delivery driver also, you know, plays your favorite song.
Okay, now, idea. Toby, you get to pick the order for the rest of the show, but Toby has three features in a row here. He's the rest of the show. It's Toby time. I'll put you full screen.
Oh, Toby time.
I believe we've got Damn News. We've got a hell of a cover song by Toby, and he is the lead actor in a music video and the lead vocalist on the Damn song. So it's Toby time.
I say let's go to cover corner first. Let me get prepared for the Damn News, because everybody needs to be prepared for it. And then we'll kill them with the movie song, Movie. There's a movie.
All right. Tell us about this These Days song.
So Jackson Browne, another guy wrote it. I meant to look it up. But Jackson Browne, one of my all-time favorite songwriters. And I didn't even really know him or listen to him for a long time, and then found out he wrote all these songs. The first time I heard the song's called These Days, was by Nico, who is in – what's the band Nico is in? I gotta look it up now. But
wait, Nico from Danger Radio?
No, not that Nico.
That Nico's good too.
This was Nico that ran with Andy Warhol. And she was in The Velvet Underground. That's what it was. She sang with The Velvet Underground, but her voice is like, she goes, I go out walking. And I just, it was in one of the, it was in some movie I saw, and I forget
it's
which
in,
one.
Yeah, it's in a big movie or multiple movies.
What's the Jason Schwartzman movie? And the one, I think it might have been in the one where he's in school.
Rushmore?
I think it might have been in that. It was one of those, maybe.
It's one of those sentimental Wes Anderson style songs. It'll feel like it's from a Wes Anderson movie, you know, when you hear it.
And then I heard the original with Jackson Brown singing, and I just liked it just as much, if not even more, just because it's just so, and he's just so great of a songwriter. So I just have always really liked this song, and I've just wanted to do songs that we never really did with Emery. You know what I mean? Just songs that are a little bit more about me and things that have moved me. So this song actually really hit me emotionally. Like I really felt this song years ago. And so I was just singing it to myself the other day. I was like, oh, I'll just do that one. So I did.
You can go ahead and change clothes if you want to. I'll give a production note on this because I think it's just fascinating. So to me, the most important thing in a production is if you could have a lead vocal take be good and, you know, all really invested, whatever it is emotionally. And then the idea of having it a complete take makes it a lot better. It really does make a difference. And then after that, it would be having it in a complete take without altering it, like tuning it or doing anything like that. And so this case of this song, I'm going to hype it up. Maybe it's overhyped because this is kind of funny, I think, from my point of view. But I didn't know the song existed until about 90 minutes ago. And then Toby said, did you get that video or that song? But it has to be mixed and the audio synced with the video of the take that he did. And I didn't know if we'd even have time to do it. But I just jumped in there real quick and put a mix on it. And I thought, you know what? I'm just going to pull the processing from the movie song. So I've got this, all of the, like, exactly what I was been working on all day on Toby's voice to this detail. And I just put it right on this track. And so it's got this ultra detailed processing but no tuning or anything, and it's a whole take, and Toby is emotionally there, like he's got a grip on the song. The take is convincing, it's pure, it's a couple hours old, and I just turned the guitar on and added the same reverb that was on his voice down to the guitar, and that's basically it. And I mixed the song for probably 4 minutes, and I haven't heard the whole song yet.
Wow, I hope that's okay.
I only had like 8 minutes to, I opened the file, did it, whatever, right. And I could track through it, and I was like, you know, because I'm sitting here in the same environment all the time listening to takes and evaluating it, and I'm just saying this was good and clean and powerful just in one take, so I think it's pretty neat from that point of view. So it's like got the least amount of effort in it, and there's a lot I think you can get out of this. I'm not trying to be dramatic, but here it is.
I've been out walking. I don't do too much talking these days. These days I seem to think a lot about the things that I forgot to do. And all the times I had the chance to, I've stopped my rambling. I don't do too much gambling these days. These days I seem to think about how all the changes came about my way, and I wonder if I'd see another highway. I had a lover,
I don't think I'll risk another these days. These days. And if I seem to be afraid to live the life that I have made in song, it's just that I've been so long. I've stopped my dreaming. I won't do too much scheming these days. These days I sit in cornerstones and count the time in quarter tones to ten. Please don't confront me with my failures. I have not forgotten them.
That was great. Oh,
that was beautiful.
Yeah, that was really good.
So I didn't actually hear it. I was watching the streams. So I was delayed. I was supposed to fall off my chair.
Yeah, you were supposed to fall off your chair.
My bad. My bad.
That was terrific, wasn't it?
Yeah, it really was. That's a great song anyway. And then Toby made it nice. Yeah,
the song is wonderful for sure. So, all right.
Well, so which version of that is the one you always hear? I go out walking, and you know what I'm talking about? Wait.
What?
Wait. I'm thinking, I just listened to the song, and now I'm confusing it with another song.
You're confusing it with Walking After Midnight.
Walking After Midnight. Oh, yeah. I go walking after midnight with my baby.
Who sings that?
BB King or something.
That's like that's like Susie Boggess or Patsy Cline or something.
Oh yeah. Patsy Cline.
That's right.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, but that song is just so.
Oh man, it's so good.
Is Patsy Cline the female Johnny Cash?
Probably.
I think so.
Or Loretta Lynn might be.
Loretta Lynn.
Oh yeah, probably Loretta Lynn. Loretta Lynn feels more outlaw a little bit or something, you know, out on the skirts, on the edges.
I had Loretta Lynn tickets at Emerald Queen Casino.
Did you?
Yeah, 2 years. I mean, she got sick and, you know, canceled. Yeah. We didn't, you know, she never came. I mean, you know, but I, you know, we had tickets that I thought it would have been really cool to see her at the casino. She was like 80 something.
Oh, man.
I don't think she's going to ever make good. She came back. I don't know, but we got refunded.
That was like my mom's favorite country singer. She was great.
Okay. Man, can you feel that music will take you all the way down to just a different emotional place? Isn't that cool? That's the way I feel.
Yeah, right. I know.
it does.
Okay, but we got to go. See, maybe it was a bad set order choice. To now, you got to go back up for the news, Toby. Can you?
I'm trying.
Can you really make that emotional turn and bring it for everybody
and turn the
whole tone around from where you just took us down to all the way back up to the damn news? Because we can skip it if you want to.
You can put the tip jar in front of me if you want.
We can skip the news if you can't take the energy back over. I can understand why you wouldn't be able to follow an act such as your previous self.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. let me see if I can do it. Let me see if I can do it.
Okay, I'm going to go full screen and I'm going to put.
I don't know if I'm going to be able to do it or not.
Yeah,
fellas.
You got
to
fix it.
I got him. I'm fixing it, and then I'm going to give him. and I'm going to give them the music here.
I don't know if I'm ready for it or not. Oh, maybe I am.
Back and back to playing for you. You got it. Okay, take it away.
All right. The damn news is back. My screen ain't working that great. But I'm doing the best I can here, and I'm excited to be back in my new home. I'm in my basement tonight, and the damn news is here, so I am ready to get to my first news story, if that's okay with you guys.
Yeah.
Yes, please do.
All right, hold on. I got to move my notes over. All right. So I thought this was just interesting. So my man Kanye West, he says that he is – this comes from NME.com. He says he's the new Moses and that the music industry and the NBA are modern-day slave ships. Now – I think I know what he's saying. Have you seen a slave ship?
It seems, like a slave ship is actually way worse probably than the NBA or
the music industry. But we were just talking about the music industry, and it, in some ways, it locks you down for your whole life, right? It's pretty crazy. The rapper says he will not share any new music until he is released from his contracts with the music publisher Sony and Universal. Kanye West has said that he will not share any of the new music until he's released from his contracts, and that he is, this is when he goes on to say that it's the music industry is like a modern day slave ship. EMI has controlled the rights to West's work since 2003. And in January of last year, West sued EMI, which we used to be on EMI.
Our catalog.
That's what I'm saying. So they aren't too good. I hope he wins this, but in an attempt to be released from his 2003 contract, which includes an agreement that he remain actively involved in writing, recording, and producing compositions and major label albums without retiring. EMI was also given the rights to West songs that he wrote prior to that agreement. In response, EMI sued West the following March for allegedly going back on his word and bargained for contractual obligations to the company. The dispute was eventually settled in January, but he is really upset that they have all the power, right? Isn't that what this is? Like, he writes the music, and they just get to use it however they want and treat him however they want. And so now he says he's the new Moses.
How is he going to set people free? I'm kind of with Kanye on this. Doesn't it feel like he has a point? Like, that old model where they own your life, that's kind of a bad model.
Yes, I think so, too.
It is.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
There was more coming there.
Yeah. Well, what about the idea of, you know, it's like I'm drawn to thinking about regular people's jobs, how they to me seem that they are owned. Do you know what I mean? Like if you work at Amazon, that's another sense when it's ownership. So either way, it seems like the big companies and the money. It's always money that does it. Where you know, you accept a good job offer, a good contract, and then that's whose fault is it, is what I'm asking.
Right.
When you're owned by somebody who paid you, you know.
Well, the problem is, I think that labels got the power in, you know, whenever they, well, I don't know, 70s, 80s maybe, is when that really like, and then bands would sign for crazy amounts of records and little money, and they had the power and they knew it, so they took advantage of it. Mm-hmm. And even till now, it wasn't until probably what, 5 or 6 years ago maybe, that you realize they don't have the power anymore.
Yeah.
Right? But they still own all this stuff. So,
and it's too bad that you signed that contract. Yeah. 2003, I mean, that's a long time to be under contract. So I can see why he's pissed.
But it'll happen again. Like I was on a call with somebody today, and they were talking about how, you know, fishing for our back catalog and saying there's people that'll buy that, there's people that'll buy that, there's people that'll buy that. And I'm thinking, but if they want to buy it, doesn't that mean I shouldn't sell it? Right?
Yes.
Right.
We should not sell.
Do you know what I mean? Like that they are speculating on it is what that means. You know, like our old catalog that EMI owns is worth more today than it was 5 years ago. It might be worth much more in 5 and 20 more years. And so, you know, but we'll make this. I mean, we're likely to make the same mistake again, because all I'll have to see is a check big enough, and then I'll sell our back catalog or something again.
That's true.
Won't just, you? And then what are you going to do? Complain?
Give it to me.
No, you know, I don't know.
Right. I'll tell them to pay me in Bitcoin. All right, moving on. I didn't bring up this picture, but let's see if I can get this picture here real quick. Because this next one, there we go.
This next one I think is pretty interesting to me. I didn't know this, but y'all know who this young lady is?
Carol Baskin.
Carol Baskin.
Carol Baskins.
So she's on Dancing with the Stars right now. The first Dancing with the Stars appearance for Tiger King star Carol Baskin featured an advertisement pleading for information about her late husband, Don Lewis. Isn't that crazy? So she's on Dancing with the Stars, but the family of her husband who disappeared, and everybody thinks maybe she did something, allegedly might have done something to end his, help him disappear. And so they, during that show, I think they're offering a $100,000 reward, and they put a commercial saying that she might have done something to their father and brother and all that stuff, their family member. Isn't that crazy that she's getting success that she probably never dreamed? She's on Dancing with the Stars, probably always thought that would, you know, that's so cool or so. And during that time, people are accusing her of murder. And so now Netflix is opening it back up and going to do a full investigation documentary on her as well. Wow. And so, so she got super famous, and what if she just gets caught now? What if, I mean, she could just be going to prison for the rest of her life. She might have literally done something.
What if she's not bad at all and all this happens to her then? Like, I mean, how would you feel if there was commercials running about you being a murderer when you didn't do it?
Yeah, but have you seen Tiger King though? I mean, it's very bizarre. I mean, so not to give too much away, but it looks like she might have, her husband, they were fighting and all of a sudden he just kind of disappeared. And she says she doesn't know anything, and it looks iffy. And now there's some other people coming out saying that they helped, like, get rid of him, put him through the meat grinder, and all kinds of stuff. Ooh. And for the tiger meat, you know, they're
even said in the show that she was already making a bunch of money from her place, right?
Yeah,
like she was like the most popular, exotic wildlife place in the country, making like tons of money.
Yeah. Animals and stuff, but anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
I loved that. That was like Tiger King happened right at the beginning of the pandemic, and I was so happy about that. I mean, I just thought it was just so great. I just love it.
I can imagine you would.
I mean, it's just right up my alley. Just everything about it, just like Joe's Gay Lovers.
Yeah, it was entertaining.
Every single thing about it was like, it was like a super long TikTok I got to watch.
That's the best way to say it. That's exactly right.
It was just like that. Super long TikTok. Yeah, that's true. I mean, it was just like that. All right. Who is this? Devin, who do you think that is? Just say real quick.
Oh, man. I guess if I'd have said right off the bat, I would have said Lady Gaga or something.
Okay.
But
Ava Max, this comes from Music News, says, stop comparing me to Lady Gaga.
Okay.
She says she wants people to stop comparing her to Lady Gaga, the sweet but psycho hit maker. I'd never actually heard of her before this, but I saw this picture. I was like, oh, there's Lady Gaga. And I was like, nope, it's not. And that's what the article is about. The sweet but psycho hit maker thinks it's weird that people compare female artists and insist it shouldn't be happening. Although the 26-year-old pop star thinks that the Grammy winner is incredible, Ava says it's lazy to put two artists in the same box because they have the same hair color and make pop music. I was like, nah, I just can't go with this one. Like,
color.
Right.
She looks a lot like Lady Gaga, and who cares? She's still doing great, and she has hits of her own and all that stuff, but what does it matter if somebody – I mean, that's what I'm saying. People think you think about them way more than you do. This lady everybody thinks about her, and she's saying, you should think about me more and notice the differences. And what she's not realizing is no one gives a damn about you at all. And you're lucky that they even go, oh, they noticed you because of Lady Gaga or something. That's a good thing.
That's like all the people that get bent out of shape that have names that are slightly off from very normal names, but they insist you pronounce them exactly right, like you did something horrible to them.
Right.
If you're Kara instead of Cara, like sorry. Yeah. I don't know.
That kind of plays to their advantage too, because I would say Lady Gaga probably capitalized a little bit on Madonna. Not at the same time, but when Lady Gaga came out, I felt this is like the new Madonna.
She
earned her own credit. Everything got validated. So if this girl could do the same thing, then we'll move on from calling her Lady Gaga.
Now
she's Lady Gaga.
From now on, she's Lady Gaga to me.
Yes. That's, I will only refer to her, no matter what she says, as Lady Gaga also.
Also Lady Gaga.
Gaga Jr. over here.
Yep. All right. This man
now
right
we're
here.
Talking. Unmistakable.
That's what
this
I like.
Ain't no right doppelgangers for this man.
Man, that's a good looking picture. Look at that
when
thing.
When you see those eyes, you know he's killed, you he's know. Murdered, he's done some. Oh. He's done some of the worst things in the world. Yeah. I love it when I watch his Instagrams or whatever, and he's like, I'm here at Studio G. And I'm just, oh, my. I mean, like, everything is so about good. Him. Studio G is Studio Garth. I mean, yeah. Everything is Garth Brand. And when you talk to when he's talking to the camera or to anybody, I'm like, this isn't a real person. And he has to do something evil to try and feel anything anymore, right? He can't feel.
Yeah,
like a nice real. Meal doesn't do it for him, you know. So, who's his wife? Is it Trisha Yearwood, I think, or something like that? Sex with Trisha Yearwood. He has to go murder. He has to annihilate, hurt, do bad things. Him and Bill Gates get together, and you don't want to know. You just don't want to know.
So many vaccines.
Oh, my God.
No matter what anybody thinks, if they got to Garth Brooks status, you become a non-human.
You don't get to
you
judge
are no
Garth
longer
Brooks.
Human.
You don't get to Nobody. Judge him or Tom Cruise. They
I'm not judging him.
No.
I'm just saying
know,
people
just
like
saying.
To make fun of them, and that's I mean, it doesn't matter. They are the and right. By the way I view it, they have sacrificed their whole right to being people. Like they aren't even it's not that they don't get a private life, it's that they're not even people. They are just yeah. icons for everybody.
Yes.
They serve a community function. They are not people. They're not people at all. They have given up that right. They're beyond people. They're something more than that. They're just these
there's
things.
No God, longer a, there's God. No longer a real personality.
I'm not saying, like, I would never, I don't want to give up being a human being, but they did.
They did, yeah.
For us. And you don't,
for us.
You don't, for
like
us.
Jesus.
I mean, you can't do what Garth and Tom Cruise and people like that do and yeah. still be a person. You have to make a choice. Right. And they made that choice yes. for us. And I am forever grateful.
Right. That's what I'm saying.
They didn't do it. They didn't do it for themselves at all.
No, well, I'm just saying they gave up something significant, but they're
yeah,
way
they didn't care
outside
about, they
the
didn't
realm
care
of
about,
human.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Garth is so amazing that I haven't even gotten to the story yet.
He's one of my favorite people.
So this is going back to your point. This is why I read this article and I was like, no, I'm going to defend Garth here. These people are being little bitches here. Listen to this. Garth Brooks backlash over CMA Entertainer of the Year. So Garth Brooks wasn't hurt by the backlash following his 7th Country Music Association Award win for Entertainer of the Year, acknowledging that it's time for someone else to take home the gong, he says. The Friends in Low Places hitmaker claimed his latest prize in November, marking the 3rd time in 4 years he has walked away with the accolade. Following the victory, Brooks made the decision to ask CMA officials to drop him from consideration for the 2020 prize because people were kind of complaining about it. He said he's received some of the responses. He said, there's one in particular that I loved. This is what Garth said. There's one in particular that I loved that said, I love you to death, but don't you think it's time that, and you should just step down and not win Entertainer of the Year. And he said a few other people did. He's 58 years old. He said he wasn't worried about the criticism. He says, I don't think it hurts at all. He says, they're not saying they don't love you. They're saying, hey, don't you think it's time? Say it's time. He said, love everybody, hug everybody, and be known as the guy who got to win it this many times. You know, he goes on to the political route or whatever. But I think he should win it as much as he wants.
Yeah.
This dude has, like you said, given everything. He's not even human anymore.
No.
I mean, he has to murder. He has to kill to just feel anything. Can he have an award? Can he have one award? Entertainer of the Year is because he's entertaining so many. He's bringing so much joy.
Michael Jackson is in that category. I'm not saying forgive him for bad things they do.
Right.
I'm just saying they've given a lot.
Yeah.
And I'll put it this way. Maybe they gave nothing. Fuck them. They're terrible. We've received a lot from them.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
We get everything.
Right.
We get to love. We get to hear Friends in Low Places. We get to make fun of him for being crazy. You know, we get to think he's, you know, we get everything out of the deal.
Yeah, we get it all. And I love it.
So, I mean, you could complain, but you just had to admit even that is a gift.
I mean, other artists should be thankful for the years that Garth didn't put anything out. I'm serious. If they get year that he doesn't put something out, they should be glad that they
don't
have
think Tiger
to
Woods
win.
Would try to. You know, I mean, Tiger Woods is another non-person. He's never a person to anybody.
Tiger Woods won the Masters too much. Can't you give the young people a chance?
I remember in the 90s, there was Jordan went and played baseball so someone else could win the MVP.
Yeah.
I mean, they had to give it to somebody else eventually. He's like, okay, you got to give it to somebody else for some reason. Same thing with Garth. You got to let people, you know, that bugs me. I am certain, though,
he's so chill about this because I am certain he knows exactly the comments, where they came from, who said them, and he will be murdering.
Yeah,
those people are dead already. They've been dead as soon as he probably told them, you signed your own death note. You know what I mean? Like, Garth Brooks is God.
I mean, isn't that the myth of sell one's soul? I mean, isn't that really where that myth comes from? Like, he can't be. Like, of course he could be a psychopath. Whatever. But he has all that way he has it. So that's why that myth originates. But that's what it is.
I hope that one day he gets prosecuted to the full extent of the law. But until that day, I will always support Garth Brooks.
Reigning
champ.
That's
the damn news. That's the damn news tonight.
That was good news tonight. I enjoyed it.
Yes. Okay. All now right, we're well, into, you know, this is a Toby song and is a Devin and Toby directed picture, correct?
Yeah. Independent film.
Oh, I've got I don't have Matt McDonald.
Hey, Matt. Sorry. Matt, can I go? Can I leave?
Yeah, man.
No, okay, I'll put you full screen. You can't leave while you're on full screen. So I will decide. can go.
All right, sweet. Everybody.
Thanks for joining, man.
Throw some tips in the jar for these guys. They're doing a good job putting out this free entertainment, almost as good as Garth Brooks.
Put your Twitch Tuesday. Tell them your Twitch in the chat here and get them to go over and subscribe while they're sitting here with us right now.
Yeah, what's your Twitch?
My Twitch is in the chat. You can just click on my profile.
Oh, there you go.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Thanks, Matt.
Appreciate it.
Have a good one, everybody. Bye-bye.
All right. Okay. So what do you want to talk about? The video, the song? What do you want? What's to discuss here before we get to it? We got Emery Land participants in this video and audio.
Oh, yeah.
So this song itself, I remember... This was one of my favorites that we recorded at the time of I'm Only a Man. It was just super upbeat, feel good, you know, just like, yeah, it was fun. It was different. Mm-hmm. And I thought, I mean, other than Cryptic Coffin, that was the one we were like, well, this is super weird song, different. Let's put it out so people don't get a poppy idea. But the movie song was my next choice. I was like, well, if we're going to go pop, let's go pop, like movie song. You know what I mean?
It's one of our only three chorus songs where there's the chorus a third time.
I thought more than the party song, I thought the movie song would be better just to put out. So it was one of my favorites when we first did I'm Only a Man.
Yeah, but it never did. It never popped as like a pop. You know, another reason we liked it a lot is because we were playing it live on the Take Action
That's
tour.
True, yeah.
We were playing Rock and Rule and movie song before we went in the studio. So we have like that was actually one of the songs that kind of like you could feel that it worked in front of crowds.
Right. Yeah.
And I don't know that it's the recording that prevented it or the placement in the album or just what the album was.
I think it was a departure of normal Toby lyrics. And there was a little bit of, tongue in cheek, a little bit saying baby and I'm the one who never makes it out of the cave. You know, that was a little it probably is the most, you're right, Devin, it's probably the most bizarre song on the record, like, that ended up on the record. I think it's just that we actually liked it. You know what I mean? Like, it was just fun. Yeah. But when I went back and even sang some of the lyrics, I was like, I wonder if I would have changed up these lyrics a little bit, because the music's really, bouncy, and you get into it, and you kind of rock, and you can kind of really sing. Like, I really just felt like it's just fun to sing the song, but it probably didn't land the same way, because I don't know if that's what people were expecting from a screamo band. You know what I mean? Maybe we'd have been one of the other bands in our genre or something that didn't do as much screamo or a little bit lighter or something here and there. Like, Amber Lynn probably could have pulled this song off more than us.
It probably would have been a better Amber Lynn song. You're right. That's a good insight. Does the chat have any thoughts on their first reactions to the song or how they take it? Because, you know, to me, is this one of those songs where it feels like it knows exactly what it wants to be? To me.
Yeah.
So I started playing on guitar and it's like whatever makes it, you could feel like it wasn't like I composed it. It just, you know, you feel like it's trying to ask you to bounce and write this lyric. It felt like it had its own way that it wanted to feel. But the way that it wanted to feel maybe isn't the normal Emery vibe. But the song seemed to very clearly take care of itself and ask for the decisions that were made in the song. Does that make sense at all? Like, it just went by feel.
Yeah.
Like, it just feels, you just play it by feel. Like, the other one that's like that is that song on, what's the song that is on Eve? It's on Eve that is the one that we redid that was your song originally that Toby did? Shit, I can't think of the name of it.
Young Boy's Dream.
Young Boy's Dream is the closest thing to this, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably.
It's just like it's like you start playing the guitar and it's just palm mute and it's like, oh, there's you don't need to do you can't like as much as I would try to add or arrange or do stuff, it's like no, it's just clearly a feel song. And so but the feel isn't the feel that's most familiar to Emery.
Yes.
Yeah,
I think you're exactly right. And even to add to that, I think it's also a little bit this was me dabbling in and you know, your mom, Matt, always said this.
Your mom. Fuck you.
No, your mom, your mama said we should do like a show tunes album or something. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I think that's kind of what this feels like. Even though even Young Boy's Dream, that's what I'm talking about. There's something there that feels like show tune. That's what I want to do. I want to do that. I wasn't doing it to write a pop song. I was doing it to do the thing that I like.
So you know Life I mean? Of the Party from Matt and Toby record taps it too then.
Oh, right? 100%.
Same thing, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just feels like, it feels like somebody on stage, like an actor could be performing that song as well, doing something. On a stage or something like a set, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like something like that. So all those songs, I still hope we do that. That would be my dream if we wrote like a musical. Like I just think that would be so fun. I would love it. I really actually do enjoy musicals, and so I just think that would just be the pinnacle of something that we could do musically. But and I think this is tapping into that for sure. So
all right, how about the video notes? How about this video?
It's a horror film.
Toby, I mean, we thought it'd be fun to film a little bit of like a comedy horror kind of thing because it's obviously lighthearted because of the song. But Toby has some good ideas for the storyline. There's this really cool park a few miles from my house that's just, it's funny because it's this old like multi-millionaire estate that got given to the University of Illinois that has all these crazy looking statues all over the grounds. And like, it's kind of like a nature preserve with all this stuff on it, but you go out there and it's free for the public and everything. So we went out there and, just filmed some pretty, pretty neat footage and stuff. So it was fun. I had a really good time with it.
It's really funny. I mean, I don't know. I won't go into all the details, but at this park, there's one thing that I wish we'd have done, a scene that I wanted to do, is you know, I'm being chased and I'm scared, but in this park are all these different statues of like naked men, like David, you know, statue type, but with the, you know, dong and balls and everything. And I just wanted to act like I was hiding, but my head was right beside one. I was hiding by the statue. I wish to God we ran out of time. But I was like, that would be so great if I was just hiding from a killer or whatever, right beside the package.
Add that in your mind when you watch this. That'll work.
Yeah, there you go.
So, but this is good. The original idea was that
tell them the idea. Just let them experience your video. I mean, I know the other one's parallel.
The other video. Yeah. That's fine. All right, go ahead.
We'll roll it. Remember, this is the update from Only a Man. It's not the final mix, but it's in good shape. There's some Emery Land vocals and gang vocals. We told them to do some spooky stuff, not what the idea was for the film, but just do some spooky on the gang vocals on it. And and so the audio's in there too. I got a lot of the audio people in there, but I'm having a hard time figuring exactly how that'll sit. So I'll probably revise that by the end. Also, frustratingly, the bridge of this song has some interesting stuff in it, and I did some piano on it last minute, and for whatever reason, excuse me, it's not in the final mix. So look forward to the updated with the cool piano and the bridge on this one.
Oh yeah.
But this turned out really cool. This is the movie song, Only a Man Update, and this is what would have cost $30,000 to make audio and video production.
Yes.
At a lower quality in 2008.
Yeah.
Here you go.
True.
Where is Devin at? I don't... Man, is it... Wait a minute. Is that Devin? Devin! Devin! Devin!
Toby!
Oh my God.
I'm the guy that dies at the beginning of the movie. I'm the one who never makes it out of the cave. It's because just when I have got everything going for me, baby, you come around and take it all away.
Whoa, whoa.
Just one kiss more. Brink, about to sink. I'm drowning, baby, and I can't think of a way to pull myself back to shore. It's your face I can't take, and my knees are about to buckle the same way as they did the night you walked through my door. Up from the inside, I will dig a foxhole for two. So you know that I will always be there for you, and maybe you could find a love for me too.
No! No! What do you want from me?
Toby! It's me, Devin!
What?
I didn't have a COVID mask, and I put this on. I can't get it off.
Oh.
Bravo! Oh, oh my gosh.
That was funny.
That was incredible. It's a real Mr. Bean of Screamo, you know?
Right. What a video, though. Man, that was fun. That was really fun to make. I forgot one thing, too. I changed up the end on my vocals, too, and then Devin added those harmonies, too, and I really liked it. Like, it's been kind of fun. We've changed a few little things here and there. Just, you know, most of the changes that we made on this album have been really simple, but it's been really fun to do that. So I added that little vocal line at the very end because I just liked it better. I just wanted to try something.
I liked it a lot.
Yes, so that's from I'm Only Man. We're nearing the end of this journey, which has been really, really good because we've built a lot of media production skills from our mix to our the two things that are really most valuable is our video production machine and our mix machine are the two things that are new that are really, really powerful. And they've gotten, you can tell how much better they've gotten just over the last like 7-8 weeks kind of thing. So we've got 2 more weeks to go on this, and then I think we're going to go into Christmas. We're going into Christmas mode right away. So that was kind of a Halloween. Yep. That was a little bit of a Halloween. Coming into fall, you could feel that fall coming in there. Speaking of Christmas, we got custom Christmas songs. That's where we're going next when we finish.
So
you can talk about that, Devin.
Yeah. I was going to say, we've got some songs. We already got a few come in. And we'll have time. I don't know what our cutoff will be. We'll probably take them up until maybe middle of November or something like that. But we have to be able to get them all done in time to get them out to Christmas. So if you're interested in getting a song, whether it's just acoustic or full band production, which we've done a handful of the full band songs, and we have a couple more left to do. One that we're working on that will hopefully be done next week. So yeah, get in there because you can add on like handwritten lyrics, you can add on personal videos, things like that. And so we'd love to get some more people involved in that for Christmas. So it's a great gift.
And just so you see, it should say probably custom songs for Christmas.
Yeah, that's probably right about that copy point.
Yeah, because we don't want to. We'll write you a Christmas song if that's what you want. We'll write anything, but. The songs can be for your loved one, for your husband, for your wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, whoever, mom, dad, all that stuff. So we'll write you a song. We were just working on some today because for our quarantine, we did this for quarantines too. People, we wrote some custom songs for them, and it's really interesting getting to write somebody else's story and not mine. Like that's what I feel so free getting to write for somebody else and capturing the love they feel or the emotions they are trying to say, you know, their emo. That's what I'm trying to get a hold of. And it's really fun. So,
yes, it's fun to write for an audience of like one or two. Like, it's weird because if you think of the opposite of like writing for a Super Bowl commercial, everybody's, you know, you have to appeal in some way. But if you're engineering or writing or making something for one person, I don't know why, but that seems to like in a way almost magnify the. Yep. You know, your decision making gets even more clear or it feels good to do.
And you can go back to a couple of these AYL episodes and we played some of those custom songs on here. So you go over to Twitch. I think it's probably where they're all I think they're all on Twitch. So go over to our Twitch account and you can watch its songs if you haven't heard them yet.
Okay, we're having a terrific night on tips. Thank you guys for paying into the tip jar, which just means you appreciate that we're spending our time and creativity doing what we enjoy doing, and it lines up with you, and we'll do more of that. Sorry, I'm not crying. I just got something in my throat.
I feel like you've been emotional all night.
It's not emotional. It's not so funny.
I didn't want to say this, but while McDonald's was playing, Jess made this delicious cornbread, and I took a bite of it, but I inhaled one of the corn kernel like. And I was going, because when he's playing, I'm trying to be as quiet as I can, but I just couldn't. I thought I was going to die. And it's just the tiniest little piece of cornbread ever just stuck right at the worst spot.
That's terrible.
So I feel you, Matt.
But we're having a great night. The Fred the dog is the top dog.
Nice.
Top dog.
Thank you, Fred.
Telemectar, who's we appreciate so much.
The demon
is in second place now.
Those are our top two.
Those are the top two tippers for the night. And so thank you guys for all the tips and everything
tonight. Thank you.
Yeah, we'll be in touch. We'll get you guys those test presses out. Someone asked on the stream, just realize that the album won't be done for another 3 weeks because after the 2 weeks, the song, and then another week of mix edits and mastering and all that stuff. Then we send it off to vinyl to press, and the vinyl takes 8 to 10 weeks. So it'll be late November before I probably get them here, and then I start shipping them out. So just so you know, it'll be
now
awesome.
I'm here, so I'll help you, Devin.
Oh, yeah, Toby helps me.
So we're going to move into Christmas mode next, both with doing songs for Christmas, and we're going to start working on some Christmas music, but we won't have time to get it pressed onto a vinyl or anything this year. But we did a good batch of Christmas songs last year that people in Emeryland have. You have to join Emeryland if you want to get those. And then we're going to do a batch of songs here, maybe three or four. And then next year we'll have a Christmas vinyl. We'll do another three or four songs next year and have something like 12 songs and do a full vinyl. And we'll order it in time that you can get it, kind of thing. So that's how we're going to shift modes. And then after that, it's still an open question on what we spend our weeks doing, but we're having a good time doing this stream and, you know, working on our skills and just being in it every week. So we'll move on to the next project for later in the year, whether we probably would spend some time on a couple of new Emery songs.
Yeah, we got to work on new Emery.
Would be the next thing probably that we'll
do some
work on, whether we take 2 weeks, you know. Oh yeah, well, I wonder if we can do those a week at a time too, if we could actually keep that, if we were focused and plan ahead. I bet we could, or we might need to take an extra week, but
or at least just show like the demo, you know what I mean? Like that would be kind of neat, like a really good demo, like instead of our just, you know, me and an acoustic guitar or whatever, like something really neat. That'd be kind of fun.
Yeah, so we're open-minded to what to do next, but having been building this and doing it regularly, it's not, the way we think of it, it's not like something we were doing short-term for COVID. This is, I mean, I'm just enjoying doing this pure, you know, as is. So we're just going to keep on this way, figure out what to work on, and we'll be here week to week. But thank you guys for supporting it and all that.
Yep. Thanks for following us to Tuesday.
Yep.
So. Yeah, thank you guys. Appreciate it.
All right, bedtime.
I hope Zuckerberg didn't kick us off, did they?
I still see us on the Zuckerbergs. So
still got Zuckerbergers.